Thank you for the kind introduction. Good evening, everyone. And today I'm going to talk to you about my research, which is on electrically controlled drug delivery. So before we get started, let's first try to discuss how do we usually take drugs? What are the problems associated with that? And why do we need new methods of drug delivery, let alone electrically controlled drug delivery? So the majority of drugs are taken either orally or through painful injections. And the problem with this kind of drug delivery is that the drug is systemically distributed. And what that means is that the drug goes everywhere in your body, and because of that, you see side effects. Another issue with this kind of drug delivery technique is that a lot of drugs have very poor bioavailability. What this means is that, let's say a drug has a bioavailability of 30%. If you're taking 100 milligrams of that drug, only 30 milligrams of it is actually what's doing the work, and the rest is all wasted. So you're paying for 100 milligrams where you should be paying for 30 milligrams. That's what's happening. And a bigger issue is in case of treating conditions which require repeated delivery of drugs, it turns out that more than 60% of the people do not stick to the prescribed regimen. In fact, in diabetic patients, it has been found that 33% of the people miss their dose at least 3 times every month. So to circumnavigate around these problems, scientists have been working on what are called these smart polymers for drug delivery. So what these polymers are really, they're like small capsules with the drug loaded onto them. And these smart polymers are stimuli responsive. So when you have a certain stimulus, the drug can be released from these particles. Now, as you may imagine, there could be several different stimuli. For example, there could be local pH changes in your body. There could be light-activated drug release, glucose-activated drug release, so on and so forth. In my research, I focus on electrically controlled drug release. And the basic idea of what we want to do is we want to make nanoparticles of conducting polymers. Now, the reason that we want to make nanoparticles is because you can really load a lot more drug onto these particles. And the reason why we want these particles to be conducting polymers is because you want to make an electric field sensitive drug delivery system, so it needs some way of, you know, being responsive to electric stimuli, so it should be conducting. And then we load these nanoparticles with the drug of choice, and then you can localize these nanoparticles in either a hydrogel or a membrane. So let's say I have some problem only in my hand here. So you can inject the hydrogel with the nanoparticles right here in the hand, so they don't go anywhere, and then the drug can be locally released. And the way that you release the drugs is by applying some sort of an electric stimuli. And the idea is that the drug should be released when the electric stimuli is applied and as long as the electric stimuli is applied. So you may ask, why are we interested in this kind of a particular system? Well, the reason is because we think that it can have really important applications. For example, it can help in the treatment of chronic diseases that require repeated doses of drugs. For example, in case of diabetes, if you can just have the nanoparticles with insulin in your body injected once, maybe you don't have to take injections every day. You just need to apply the electric stimulus when you need the insulin, and it can be released again and again. You can use this kind of a technology for treatment of inoperable tumors. And you can imagine that maybe you can make a small chip containing these nanoparticles, and then many drugs do not penetrate the blood-brain barrier. And if you implant this chip directly in the brain, then you can release the drug directly in the brain. In fact, 98% of all the drugs do not penetrate the blood-brain barrier. So this is a very neat way of getting medication to the brain without facing this problem. Now, this is a lot of fancy talk about drug delivery, but what is it that I do? And I'm a simple chemist. So what I do is I make these nanoparticles using a simple technique called a microemulsion technique, and it's a one-step technique. So what we do is we take a solution containing the monomer that builds, which is the building block of the polymer and the drugs, and the polymer is called polypyrrole. And then we add an oxidizing agent. And once we add the oxidizing agent, we get these nanoparticles which are loaded with the drug. So imagine that these drug-loaded nanoparticles are pretty much like small meatballs, and the drug is like a salt. So what do these nanoparticles look like? Well, they look like meatballs, except they're really, really small. And how small? They are about 30 to 40 nanometers in size, which is roughly 2,000 times smaller than the thickness of your hair. Now, onto these nanoparticles, we have loaded fluorescein, which is a model compound, and it's colored, it's green, so you can easily track whether the system is working or not, whether it's releasing when you apply the electric stimulus or not. And once we figured out that we can make this system work, we tested the system again with a molecule called piroxicam, which is a real drug, and it's used in treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, and this is a drug that you really need again and again. And then what we found was that you can release these drugs when you apply some sort of electric stimuli, and you can release the drugs in a linear fashion. And the reason why this is pretty great is because now you can develop a relationship between the drug release and the electric stimuli that you're applying. So if you want to know, if you know that, okay, this is the amount of drug I need, then you know exactly what's the electric stimulus that you should apply to release that amount of drug. So this can really help in the development of a programmable drug delivery device. Okay. Now, both fluorescein and piroxicam are small molecules. Can we really release larger molecules, something like insulin, which would have a much bigger impact? And turns out that yes, we can also release insulin using electric stimuli in a linear fashion. Now, what exactly am I talking about when I say electric stimuli? I'm talking about voltages as low as 0.5 volts. That's smaller than a 1-volt battery that you hold in your hand. So that will really not have much side effects in your body. It's a really, really weak voltage. Okay, so now I'm a chemist. We know how to make these nanoparticles, but how do you use them? How do you get the electric stimulus to these nanoparticles? Do you first put the nanoparticles in the body, and then every time you need the drugs to be released, you stick into electrodes and release the drug? Is that how you do it? That kind of makes it more invasive than it originally is, so it makes the problem bigger, right? So how do you use it? Well, imagine you can have some sort of small chip, and you have a problem somewhere here in your body, in the red dot, right? And imagine this is your chip with the nanoparticles, and somehow you can trigger drug release from this chip using a remote, right? And then the drug gets released. If you can have something like this, then that would be fantastic. And if you can make the chip completely wireless and you can power it externally so that it doesn't need any battery, so you need drug and you're out of battery, that situation never happens. If we can do something like this, then you can really have a drug delivery system that's programmable, that's adjustable, so you can adjust the drug dosage based on how the patient is responding to the drug. And you can also integrate sensing capabilities onto this chip. And what that means is it can track some biological molecules in your body. So the response, for example, you release insulin and you see it's really not enough to lower your glucose levels. So the chip can automatically release more insulin. So you can do this kind of things with a chip like this. But how do we make the chip? So then I started Googling, and I found that we have a young professor here on campus who works on making small chips as medical devices, right? And if you can see here in the picture that the chip is really small, it's almost the size of the tip of a pen. So then I thought that if I can combine our nanoparticles with their chip, then we can actually make this drug delivery system. So I approached their group, and then we started working on this, and we have done preliminary studies, and it seems to work so far. And the way that in which we can use this is for treatment of conditions such as brain tumors, like glioblastoma, for example. So if you remove the primary tumor, then what happens is in glioblastoma, it has a really high recurrence rate, so it keeps coming back. Right? So what you can imagine is you just put the chip in there. So whenever you go to the doctor for regular checkups, and if the doctor thinks you're getting the cancer back, you press a button and the drug gets released. But if not, then the chip just stays there and it doesn't leak any drug. So this is the kind of work that we are doing right now. And this work would not have been possible without the support of my team. So my team consists of people from both the chemistry department as well as the Department of Electrical Engineering at Stanford. I would also like to thank my advisor, Professor Richard Zare, for constantly supporting me and motivating me. This is a really hard project, as you can imagine, and in fact, I was struggling with it for about 2 years before we got it working. And he never lost faith in me, and he constantly supported me, so I'm really thankful to him for that. And I would also like to thank Professor Arbabian for agreeing to collaborate with us for making this technology much more practical. And I would also like to thank people in our lab, including my friend Katie, who's here to my talk. And I would also like to thank the Center for Molecular Analysis and Design and the Stanford Graduate Fellowship for providing me with funding. And finally, I would like to thank Natalie Jabbar for giving me the opportunity of speaking here, as well as you for your attention. Thank you.